Today on the important films of 1952, we have a musical double feature, so let's get to it. First up, Singin' in the Rain, originally released on March 27th, 1952. The classic musical features songs by Nassiel Herb Brown, with lyrics by Arthur Freed, enhancing a screenplay by Betty Comden and Adolph Green. It was directed by Gene Kelly and Stanley Donen. I didn't remember if I'd already seen this movie when I sat down to watch it for this series. It's one of those movies that most people have seen, or at least seen bits and pieces of throughout the years, if they have any interest in classic films, as I do and always have. I realized quickly that I had never seen it, certainly not in full. But like a lot of people, I was certainly familiar with it. Anyone watching this probably is too. I think there are probably two major things that come to mind, which actually have nothing to do with this film specifically, though they are cinematic references. When anyone in my general age group, let's say between the ages of 35 and 50, thinks of the title song, the classic scene with Gene Kelly dancing in the rain and twirling around the lamppost and all that is, of course, very famous. Even if you've never seen this movie, you've definitely seen that scene, either in full or in parts. It will always show up in retrospective documentaries, and since this film always shows up on those AFI lists or VH1 lists or whatever lists where you have celebrity talking heads making snarky comments, sometimes insightful, but always scripted, and usually snarky, about the movie, they will invariably show clips. And Gene Kelly, with his dookie-colored raincoat and hat, dancing around and singing the song and looking up into the camera with his arms outstretched like Scott Stapp, while the rain falls onto his face and he smiles orgasmically, that's the clip they usually show. And if you've been on that ride at Disney World, I think it's called The Great American Movie Journey Through American Movies, or something like that. I think it's at the Hollywood Studios Island, or Park, whatever they call it, which is usually ranked third, behind Magic Kingdom and the Animal Kingdom parks. Yes, of course Epcot is ranked fourth. Of course it is. Though maybe not anymore, since I think they have booze there now. But anyway, on that ride, which is about animatronic recreations of famous movie scenes while you sit in a slow-moving, movie theater-like contraption for something like 25 minutes, animatronic Gene Kelly recreating that scene is the first thing you see. But to my initial point, people in my age group don't tend to associate that song with that film or that scene. Or maybe I should just stop saying things like my generation or people in my age group. It's presumptuous to assume things like that, so I'll just say I associate it with two things. There is, of course, the very famous thing, which is some 19 years after this film was released, and that is Malcolm McDowell, in the role of Alex DeLarge, kicking the shit out of Patrick McGee as his cohorts rape the poor guy's wife while belting out the classic song in Stanley Kubrick's A Clockwork Orange. But the one that immediately springs to mind, because it's far less unpleasant, is actually Jean Reno, with a childish smile on his face, munching on some popcorn and looking up at a big movie screen as he watches this movie at a New York revival house in the film Leon. Yes, that's right, I call it Leon because I prefer the international 135-minute cut of The Professional, which actually has that title. And if I'm being honest, I'm not sure if he's munching on popcorn. Maybe he is, or maybe I'm having a Mandela effect moment with regards to that detail, but he's definitely sitting in a movie theater watching the movie, and he's definitely smiling like a kid would. And then later, because of his familiarity with the film, it is the only answer he's able to get right when Natalie Portman plays musical charades with him in a heartwarming scene that only the most diseased lunatic would want to claim is actually puerile. Like, seriously, if you have a problem with that scene, if it makes you feel uncomfortable in some way, if you can't just look at it as a cute scene of playtime and familial bonding between a young girl and her surrogate father, then, I mean, the problem is you. It lies within you. Look at yourself and ask yourself why you are experiencing these complicated feelings, which is not to say, of course, that Leon doesn't explore the very complicated intricacies of a relationship between a 12-year-old girl and an adult man she has come to see as a role model and potential father figure, but has also developed a crush on. The important thing is that Leon himself, even with his limited intellect, it is implied he's mentally challenged in some way beyond his mastery of being a world-class assassin. We know he is illiterate and functionally possesses a childlike mind. Even within that limited intellect and emotional immaturity, he understands that a romantic or sexual relationship between himself and this 12-year-old would be grossly inappropriate as well as immoral and even criminal, and he does not respond to or act on her romantic advances in any way. So the film is realistic about portraying what it portrays, is what I'm saying. Consider that there's a very popular episode of The Simpsons called Lisa's Substitute, in which Lisa, aged 8, develops a huge crush on her erudite substitute teacher, Mr. Bergstrom, wonderfully played by Dustin Hoffman. And it's a similar situation, where Lisa is lacking in a strong adult male role model and comes to see Mr. Bergstrom in that light, but also clearly has a bit of a whimsical romantic crush on him. And nobody has ever taken that episode to task about it being creepy and inappropriate and weird, because it isn't. And the only reason film Twitter likes to give Leon the professional shit now is because it has become fashionable to hate on Luc Besson, a French filmmaker with a romantic penchant for younger women. But whatever your personal feelings for Luc Besson may be, there is nothing specifically immoral or wrong or creepy about Leon, the film or the character. But anyway, back to Singin' in the Rain. I was, of course, familiar with this picture, but I had never seen it until just now, and well, I am happy to say that it's a movie. It's a movie that exists. Okay, that's mean. It is definitely a good movie, just maybe not really my cup of tea. And that's not to say I don't like musicals. I do, just this one in particular doesn't blow me away. But you know what? Fuck it. Let's discuss this movie's good points, which are several. It's very nicely put together. It has that nice Technicolor look to it, the dynamic, colorful visuals, courtesy of vibrant production design and camera work, and ultimately the splendid choreography for the musical sequences, all clearly the expertise of Gene Kelly and Stanley Donen, who were coming to this fresh off their resounding success with An American in Paris the previous year. And so here we have a similarly whimsical tale that takes full advantage of Kelly's talents as a song and dance man and his undeniable charisma and likability as a romantic lead. It's also clear the people involved have a very keen understanding of the world they're exploring, and they should, because this is a showbiz comedy. It's a movie about Hollywood in the late 1920s and the dawn of the talkie. The fact it's a period piece nostalgically observing the recent past makes it of a piece with something like Rock of Ages. Seriously, it's looking back about 25 odd years with an eye towards pop culture elements, and something else it has in common with Rock of Ages is it's basically a jukebox musical, and what I mean by that is most of the music here already existed prior to the film. None of the big songs were originally composed for it, not even the title tune. Speaking of which, about Rock of Ages, it's kind of weird to me how that movie doesn't ever actually use the Def Leppard song it was named after. But anyway, all these are existing songs in the MGM catalog from previous musicals that were released in the 20s and 30s, the time basically depicted in the film. Singin' in the Rain already existed as a song and had been featured in the Hollywood Review of 1929. It makes sense to use this music to depict this period, just as it makes sense to use glam rock to depict the struggles of a club on the Sunset Strip in 1987. The transition from silent films to talkies relied heavily on musicals for a number of reasons. First and foremost, many of the actors in silent films were performers, for sure, with experience in vaudeville and whatnot, but they weren't always the most skilled theatrical actors. Back then, film was seen as a lesser form. It was considered vulgar entertainment for the masses, and since the films were silent, actors did not need theatrical training. They didn't need to learn proper diction and enunciation or any of that. They didn't need to train their voices for anything. And the actors who did have some training probably had it as singers and dancers, so that was exploited in the early talkies, and the crowds coming to see the film could get a similar spectacle to what they might get in musical theater, singing, dancing, and a grand old time for the whole family. But maybe let's get good at this before we give people The Iceman Cometh or Macbeth. Let's save that for the classiness of theater until film catches up. And that's what Singin' in the Rain is about. It's about Gene Kelly as a dashing leading man, the star of many great adventures in the Errol Flynn mold, and his frequent co-star played by Gene Hagen, who is a stunning beauty and has all she needs to be a silent film star so long as she never needs to open her mouth, because we learn, off-screen, she is actually a rather terrible person, and moreover, she is cursed with a horrendously shrill voice and has absolutely no talent for singing or dancing. But then along comes Debbie Reynolds, a young up-and-coming showgirl in training, who hopes to one day hit the big leagues, but for now must be content to just pop out of cakes at high society birthday parties. but she is clearly a talented young woman in all the ways Gene Hagen is not. And Gene Kelly meets her and falls in love with her and feels he can help her become a star of the stage and screen as she deserves to. And I mean, I won't summarize the plot anymore. I think it's pretty clear that this is basically a comedic take on the Star is Born formula with some Hollywood parody thrown in. The movie is basically very amiable and likable. As I said, none of the songs really blow me away, but they're not bad songs. They're catchy. Especially the most famous ones, which are, of course, the title tune and another ditty that comes about halfway through called Good Morning, and then there's Make 'Em Laugh. The performances are all on point, even though you get that old-timey emphatic comedy acting where people are shouting all their lines as if they were standing on the tarmac at LaGuardia or something just as the flight to Miami was taking off. And of course, everyone speaks in that mid-Atlantic inflection, so yeah, it is what it is in that sense. But Gene Kelly is definitely a pro at what he does. I'm not sure he's one of our greatest actors. I may come to appreciate him as I see more of his work, because I honestly haven't seen that much. But he's definitely one of our greatest performers. The man is good at what he does. He's one of Jackie Chan's idols, and you can definitely see why in this film. The man has a grace that is unmistakable. When I say he's not a great actor, I simply mean his range is probably limited. He's very good at playing this particular role here, the likable and slightly aloof romantic lead, but like, I don't know that he would be just as good at playing a disgusting white supremacist, or a serial rapist, or even a Bond villain. I think this is about all he can do, but it's a good thing, and he does it well. Debbie Reynolds is simply luminous. This was her first big role, and you can understand why she conquered hearts. Her role in the film mirrors her actual career progress, which was similar for most Hollywood starlets in that their big star-maker performances were ultimately fictionalized versions of themselves. That's the case here. You have this very smart and snappy young woman, only 19 or 20 when the film was shot, something that her daughter, Carrie Fisher, would come to mirror 25 years later in her own big movie break. And she's very talented, but kind of comes from nowhere and gets by on her undeniable talent and, yes, girl-next-door looks. That's kind of the point. She's not a head-turning bombshell like the character Gene Hagen plays, but she doesn't need to be. She's perfectly cute and very pretty in her own right, and besides, she possesses all the mountains of talent that Gene Hagen does not. For my money, the movie's kind of stolen by Donald O'Connor in the role of Kelly's former partner on the vaudeville stages, who becomes the musical director of the fictional Hollywood studio depicted in the film. He's just naturally and effortlessly funny and likable and kind of comes off like the scene Closer whenever he's on screen. And that's that. That's the movie. That's what I mean. There really isn't very much to it. The title song is the most famous, as I said, but the big set piece of the film actually comes towards the end. It's the surreal presentation of the Broadway Melody, which is a kind of medley and features some show-stopping stuff in the art direction and the dancing, courtesy of Gene Kelly and his dance partner for the sequence, Sid Charisse. It's the sort of thing that probably in 1952 was seen as really hot and heavy, and you have to look at it in that context. And if I'm also being 100% honest, it kind of goes on for a bit too long. I didn't keep tabs, but it certainly felt like one of those prog rock songs that just keeps going and going, and there's a 10-minute solo, followed by another verse and chorus, and then a bridge, and then it climaxes with another 10 minutes of drum and bass virtuosity. And so, that's the movie. Something else it has in common with Rock of Ages, it was not as widely embraced at the time of its release as you might think. Musicals were still a popular genre. The previous year, An American in Paris had been a big hit. This one, I think it was like the 10th highest grossing film of the year, which is not a bad thing at all, but when you consider how famous it went on to be, a bit surprising it wasn't higher on the box office scale. That doesn't matter, of course, but it's an interesting detail, and anyway, the movie is good. And in any case, I did like it quite a bit more than With a Song in My Heart, a musical biopic that was released on April 4th, 1952, written by Lamar Trotti and directed by Walter Lang. I guess one thing this movie has over Singin' in the Rain is its music. Once again, this is also a bit of a jukebox musical because it's based on the life of a real person who actually performed all of these songs. And these songs are all classic pop standards dating back to the 30s and 40s, and they're all pretty good. You've probably heard them pop up in Woody Allen movies or whatever, but my point is, the music is not bad at all, and I'll get into that. But first, what's up with the crests? Yeah, this has a strange opening credit sequence where you have these weird crests pop up on the lower left corner of the frame, and I don't understand what they mean. Are we meant to think that the people involved in the cast and crew are somehow royalty? I don't know. The crests look nice, but I don't understand. And then we have a title card that tells us this film is based on the true story of this extraordinary artist and how the voice you will hear is hers. This is kind of a key thing, and it makes the picture rather unique among musicals in that all the singing is done by just one character, and the actress playing that character isn't even the one doing the actual singing. She lip-syncs to the woman she's playing, who actually does all the singing. That's kind of funny, actually, since a big plot point of Singin' in the Rain also involves an actress basically lip-syncing to a singer. But anyway, that's about all this movie has in common with Singin' in the Rain. It's nowhere near as interesting, nowhere near as dynamic, and nowhere near as entertaining. Yes, at the very least, even though it's not a favorite of mine, I can definitely say Singin' in the Rain is entertaining. It's a movie of technicolor spectacle, of showmanship. This one, not so much. There's a weird stuffiness to it. It was also shot in Technicolor, but it never quite pops. I guess that's because this is not meant to be a fanciful entertainment, but rather a celebration, a tribute to a then-still-living pop star and her extraordinary talent and supposedly fascinating life. I mean, from the movie itself, all you can really gather that is interesting about her is that she is one of the rare pop stars to have actually survived the plane crash. But everything else, I mean, yeah, she came from nowhere and had a quick rise due to her talent, and then she fell in love with her manager and musical partner, one and the same they were, and then it turns out that maybe she didn't love him so much, so she eventually fell in love with the pilot of the plane she was on that crashed. There's nothing particularly interesting about the plane crash or the love triangle, both of which are basically the emotional linchpins of the whole movie. Now, one thing I must confess is I had never heard of Jane Froman before I saw this movie. She was a huge star, apparently, and of course, she had to have been, since they made a whole movie about her, and she was kind of a contemporary star in the sense that the film is dramatizing events barely a decade in its past. But anyway, I'd never heard of her, and I had never heard of this movie when I sat down to watch it, and I have to be honest and admit that it was kind of an excruciating experience. Okay, I guess that is a bit of an exaggeration. It wasn't quite that excruciating, because as I said at the top, the songs are nice, and the songs are, I suppose, the film's central reason for being. They are all performed in full. This movie actually has more music in it than Singin' in the Rain, and each song is performed from start to finish, and the film climaxes with, you guessed it, a medley, which seems to last about 10 minutes. And the funny thing is, you can actually look away from the screen and just listen to the movie. Just listen to the movie while playing Candy Crush or Matchington Mansion on your iPhone. And you will have pretty much the same experience you would have if you actually watched it, because there's nothing there. The movie is pretty boring when it isn't focused on its music. And then one of the dozen or so musical numbers comes on, and you don't really need to look at it either, because these numbers are not staged and choreographed by Gene Kelly and Stanley Donen. These numbers are all Susan Hayward in the role of Jane Froman, standing on a stage in some club or theater and lip-syncing for the entire length of a particular song. Oh, she does the whole pantomime thing, of course. She gestures to her audience. She makes some wry comments. My point is, you're watching a straightforward filming of a straightforward club performance. These aren't vibrant spectacle sequences. If there were good quality footage of a Jane Froman concert, you'd be better off just watching that instead of this boring movie wrapped around a series of simulated Jane Froman performances. Which is not to say it's badly acted or anything, it isn't. It's perfectly fine for the standards of the time. Susan Hayward does a good job in the role, in the sense that it's a convincing and realistic dramatic performance. I don't know how close she comes to evoking the real person, since I am unfamiliar with the real Jane Froman, but I imagine it must be pretty good. In any case, Froman herself approved, of course, since she was a technical advisor on the film and provided Susan Hayward with her singing voice. Something Hayward has to do is convince you she is this person and she is performing these songs, and she does manage to do that, so it's definitely a good performance. Her co-stars are pretty good, too. You have David Wayne in the role of her manager-slash-partner and first husband, and there is a pathetic quality to this sad sack character, which Wayne brings off well. And then you have Rory Calhoun, who was second billed, but actually doesn't show up until almost an hour into the fucking thing, and this movie is an hour and 55 minutes long, so that means the second billed co-star spends half the movie not being in it. But I guess that doesn't matter. Anyway, he's a bit stiff, if I'm being totally honest. He's supposed to be the dashing dude who sweeps Jane Froman off her feet. And sure, the guy is a convincing slab of 1950s beefcake, but so what? I think that's an essential problem with the film as a whole. It's flat as a pancake. Here's a movie in which there's a catastrophic plane crash about halfway through it, and there's this central romantic conflict at the center of it, and yet it never generates any real emotion. Part of it could be that, since Jane Froman herself was involved in the film's production, they didn't want to step on anybody's toes, kind of like Bohemian Rhapsody, you know what I mean? Where Brian May and Roger Taylor were involved in the film's production. So they kind of guided the movie along to be the very family-friendly version of the story of Queen. Where, yes, it's a tribute to Freddie Mercury and his colossal talent, but also, since he's dead, let's you and I come off like absolute saints and throw him under the bus as an absolute dick and a pompous diva, you know what I mean? But don't worry, because we'll still give the movie a happy ending, even though the man died of AIDS. Anyway, this is kind of like that. I mean, here you have this woman who is plucked from obscurity, and then she marries her best friend, the man who plucked her from that obscurity, and she never truly loves him. And that's truthful. That happens. Because the heart wants what it wants. And you can never choose who you will fall in love with, no matter how much you may care for them as people or how much they do for you. You'll still get a hard-on for the handsome pilot played by Rory Calhoun. You see what I'm saying? That should be a major dramatic conflict, but the movie handles it in a very cheap, half-assed way, with Jane Froman crying into her hands because she can't deal with it for a couple of minutes. And then this really pathetic, flat scene in which David Wayne and Rory Calhoun have a couple of drinks together, and Wayne basically admits that the best man won. Later on, Wayne does some kind of silly, drunken acting into a telephone, and then there's another long musical number, and the movie just ends. The movie generates more dramatic emotion out of Robert Wagner. Parenthesis. Did he do it? Do you think he did it? Was it him or Christopher Walken? Oh, it was an accident. Are you sure about that, though? Are you really sure? Does it really scan? Anyway, parenthesis over. Robert Wagner is this GI paratrooper who shows up twice. First as a kind of starstruck dum-dum at a club, and then later as a shell-shocked tragedy of a man who Jane Froman is able to resurrect through the power of song. And that's corny as hell, but at least it's entertaining. The movie has an interesting narrative device, I'll give it that. It's narrated by the three most important people in Froman's life. Wayne as her first husband, Rory Calhoun as the pilot she fell for, and Thelma Ritter, the most interesting character in the picture, as the rather butch but still heteronormative nurse who basically became her personal assistant slash best friend. The three characters narrate the story contextually, depending on where we are in the story, where they come in. Kind of like Casino, you see what I'm saying? Hell, Marty Scorsese is no stranger to classic Hollywood cinema. Maybe he got that idea from this. But unfortunately, there isn't a scene of David Wayne beating Rory Calhoun to pieces with a baseball bat and then burying him alive. A scene like that would have all but confirmed its influence, of course, but more than anything else, it would have given some life to this turkey. But like I said, good songs, good soundtrack. In fact, back in the day, the soundtrack album was the best-selling album of the year. People bought it by the truckload and spun it like crazy in their living rooms, and it was subsequently reissued on CD and stuff. And I guess what I'm saying is that you should do. You should track down the soundtrack album for With a Song in My Heart. I think you can find it on Spotify. It's out there in any case, so you can listen to the title song and songs like That Old Feeling and My Blue Heaven and I'm Through with Love. And I mean, these are all lovely songs, and I have no doubt Jane Froman was a lovely woman, and she definitely had a lovely voice. Shame the movie about her was such a dud. Hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope you keep following along on this journey as I go through all the classic films of Hollywood's golden age and beyond. Go ahead and give me a like, hit subscribe, and hit that bell so you can be notified of new videos. Feel free to leave me a comment as well, and please do share this with anyone who you think might enjoy it. There's also a Patreon link if you want to throw me a couple of bucks, and thanks for your support. I'll be posting new videos in this series and others every couple of days or so just keep a lookout. And I'll see you next time.